can we open the meeting, and could I just start by welcoming everyone here this morning, both officers and members, and a special welcome to our new member, Councillor Terry Bryce from
Item 1, appointment of chair. Do you have any nominations?
Nominate Tony Concepcion.
Second item, appointment of deputy chair. Have nominations? Can I nominate Diane?
Oh, second idea.
Apologies for absence. We have had apologies from the Director of Finance, who was unable to attend today, so Carl's going to cover his report. Is there any other?
Yes, Councillor Johansson.
Minutes, item 4, minutes of the authority meeting held on the 26th of April. They agree? Item 5, declarations of interest by members and officers. Item 6, questions from members on the procedural rule 9.
Not received.
Item 7, questions from members of the public on the procedural rule 10.
Not received.
Item 8, motion proposed by members on the procedural rule 15.
Not received.
Item 9, scheme of delegation and procedural rules. Paul, you're going to take us through this, are you?
Yeah, thank you, Chair. This is an annual report every year. The scheme of delegation is the document which sets out and forms the authority's constitution, and it also defines the authority's governance arrangements. I'll go right through the scheme of delegation, but it's detailed in paragraph 3.1 of the decision-making process of the report. The authority is required to resolve the scheme of delegation at its annual general meeting each year. The existing scheme of delegation has been reviewed and no amendments are proposed, so therefore members are requested to resolve the scheme of delegation attached at Appendix 1, page 13 of the report.
Have members got any questions? Can I move that the scheme of delegation be adopted for the 2019-20 municipal year? Item 10, which is the questions and the discharge of functions, which is Paul again.
This is an annual report. The authority nominates members at its annual meeting each year. For information, paragraph 3.1 of the report lists the members nominated in the previous municipal year. This report seeks nominations as to which members shall be responsible for answering questions on behalf of the authority at their respective constituent council proceedings.
Okay. With our new colleague from Knowsley, Councillor Byron. Liverpool, Laura.
Thank you.
St. Helens is not present. Sefton.
Yeah.
And Will, Tony?
Yeah.
Okay. So it's just the St. Helens, but we'll confirm with St. Helens. Okay?
Okay.
Agreed? Okay. Item 11, which is appointments to committees. Paul, are you?
Okay, this is an annual report. this report seeks to make all the necessary appointments and approvals in relation to the authorities, committees, and outside bodies. The 1920 lease of the year. It also seeks agreements for the terms of reference and appointments to the authorities for panel. Appendix 2 of page 36 of the report provides a table indicating the nominations required. Therefore, the report also seeks delegated powers to the clerk in consultation with all members to finalise any outstanding appointments. There was a request for a sort of expression of interest which I forwarded to yourself.
Right, we have the forward planning panel, and we've had expressions of interest. Last year it was Councillor Harbour from Knowsley, Councillor Sayers, Councillor Preston and myself. And the expressions of interest this year has been from Councillor Preston and Councillor Sayers and myself. Okay, the Appeals Committee, we have four members. Again, Councillor Harbour was from Rosie. Would you like to take her place on?
I've done loads of them in the previous life, yeah.
So you're quite happy to continue. We've had expressions of interest also from Councillor Sayers and Councillor Williams. Are OK?
Yeah.
OK. Audit and Governance Committee, we need four members. We've had interest from Councillor Williams, who was on that committee last year. Again, Councillor Harbour was representing those. Would you like to take their place again?
Fine.
Joe Hansel was on it last year, but he's not here, so he followed. And Councillor Oscar.
The only issue I've got is that I'm away, and I know that that was something that was mentioned a couple of weeks ago. We got to have that meeting.
Yeah, July, at the end of July. There is an audit and governance committee scheduled for the end of July. If the other councils attend, we still will be.
Yeah,
I've got a date for that one yet. Exactly.
It will be probably still the last Friday in July, but I'll confirm with the Director of Finance on his return.
Thank you. OK, so you're happy to continue, but...
Yeah.
Right, OK. The next committee is the Investigative and Disciplinary Committee. We need three reps from separate districts. We've had expressions of interest from Councillor Byron, Councillor Williams and Councillor Okay. We'll also need to nominate the chair. Last year it was Councillor Williams, who's indicated that he's happy to continue in that role. Can we agree that?
Right.
Okay. Merseyside Holdings, we can have up to four members. Currently we have myself and Councillor Roscoe. And Councillor Preston is up for renewal. Is anybody else interested in joining us on the major race? No? So we need to contact Councillor Preston.
Oh, he's expressing interest.
Oh, well.
Yeah.
Very good. Okay, so we've got a lot of you.
Yeah.
Okay. Bidston, Bidston Methane, we need three members. We've got expressions of interest from Councillor Preston and Councillor Williams. Last year it was also Councillor Norbury.
Yeah, happy to.
Okay. And the North West Employers Organisation, again, it was Councillor Norbury, who's indicated that he'd like to continue.
Yeah, sir.
Okay. So that completes that, I think. Okay. Now we come on to item 12, which is the outturn report. Carl is going to take us through.
Do my best, Chair.
Thank you.
So you've got the outturn report, provides members with an overview of the financial performance of the authority for last year, 18-19. Report deals with capital, revenue and prudential indicators. On the capital side, we didn't have a significant capital programme last year. We're waiting for the results of the strategic review and the national strategy. There was a 21k spend in the year on access controls at South Sefton. Some of you will know, around the control of commercial vehicles on the site. That scheme has proved successful and we're looking to work with our contractor to look at other sites where we can do the same kind of works. Any further significant expenditure on capital schemes in current or future years is also likely to require further prudential borrowing. On the revenue side, and I'm looking at pages 40 to 44 and appendix 1, the outturn shows the general fund is just below 2 million. It's lower than hoped for, but the reason for that is the planned release of funds from the authority's wholly owned company, Merseyside Holdings Limited, has been delayed, and that will come in this year instead. So it's a technical accounting issue. Our accountants' advisors were unable to provide advice before the year end. Once that is secured, the balances would go back to about 4.5 million, which is considered prudent by the Director of Finance. So they're a little low at the moment, but it's a timing issue about the release of funds from our company. you'll see from the report there are some areas of activity where spending was lower than anticipated, and there was underspend, particularly on establishment costs, bar a pension payment increase. There was an overall underspend. On the contracts budget, the RRC was underspent by 317k, and on the WMRC, there was an underspend of 389,000. So overall, underspend on both contracts of 706,000. On a relatively small budget, again, closed landfill sites, again, there was a saving of just short of 50k on closed landfill sites. There was a small overspend on rent, rates and impairment budget of 5k. There's a technical overspend on a depreciation line of 2.36 million. But again, this is offset later in the technical accounting. It's happened as a result of the revaluation of assets at the year end, particularly in relation to the RRC. Those technical accounting adjustments are offsetting. There were other underspends on recycling credits, which means there was less waste diverted from residual than been hoped for from the districts. There was an underspend on the strategy budget, small underspend. Slight overspend on the behavioural change line of the budget. However, that again reflects the fact that the community fund budget's been moved into the admin line. So overall, in fact, there was an underspend on that overall budget of 51k. Small underspend on the permit scheme, 11k. And the big 2.5 million dividend from our company, as I've explained, is a matter of timing. And finally, the interest costs on loans are higher than been anticipated due to interest rate changes of 120k. And at the year-end evaluation of the assets was completed, the technical accounting adjustments for depreciation and minimum revenue provision were 401,000 higher than expected, which couldn't have been anticipated at a revised estimate. So that's now been put straight. On balances and reserves, and I'm on page 44, I mentioned the reserves being 1.9 million, and as I explained, when the dividend from the company is released, this general fund will move back to 4.5 million, which is considered a more normal level of reserve for the authority. On prudential indicators, on page 45 and appendix 2, they'll be updated to reflect the year-end revaluation of assets and the internal borrowing from St. Helens Council on commercial loans, move to commercial loans. The indicators demonstrate the authority set borrowing limits that were affordable and confirmed to members that the authority remained within its prudential borrowing limits for the year. Happy to take any questions.
Okay, thanks, Carl.
You said reserves are low because you expected some funds to come in from Merseyside telling things that hasn't come in this financial year.
Yeah.
Is there any possible, like, immediate risk implication to do that? Is there anything that could possibly happen that we would go, oh my God, we really needed that to be there now?
Never say never around risk, but the prudent position wouldn't be to have this low level of reserves.
Yeah.
However, on a risk assessment basis, because we're not in procurement, because we've built out the facilities and we've had full operational years of the RRC and all the rest of it, the current risk environment for the authority is pretty low. There's no big expected build programme for the authority. There's no big expected legislation changes or anything like that that should impact. So we're in actually a low risk environment at the moment. In the next few years, as the government strategy starts to bite and councils and the waste authority have to do things,
yeah,
then you're carrying a bit higher risk. You know, it is a timing issue, so we will get back to that position, but at the moment we are in a relatively low risk position because we're not very active in terms of building or procuring.
So there isn't anything you can think of that would suddenly go, oh my goodness, we need
touch wood whistle, nothing we can see that surprises.
Tony, can you just go through the behavioural change spend mapped into the recycling targets? Because you said that the recycling is not where it should be. The behavioural change funding has gone up, hasn't it? Just go through that.
Okay. They're not necessarily related. Obviously, it's a relationship. But the two things, the recycling credits, which we pay districts, have gone down. That's because districts aren't recycling as much. So that's really straightforward.
Yeah.
There's a number. If they recycle whatever tons, then they get paid recycling credits. That has gone down by 160k. On the behavioural change line, there's an apparent overspend of £64,000. But that is because the budget that sits elsewhere, the £115,000 community fund, now sits in the admin lines, and there was an underspend on those lines. So overall, there has been an underspend in that group of budgets for £51,000. Does that make sense?
It makes sense. Maybe come to it later on. Yeah.
Okay. Steve? Thanks, Chair. The dividend for the £2.5 million, have we got any time approximations of when that will be coming to fruition? Is it going to be in this financial
year? It's going to be in this financial year. Yeah. Yeah, I haven't got a date for you, Councillor, but it will be in this financial year.
Okay. Okay.
Okay. Have members got any other questions? Okay. Can you just note the report? That will be.
Thank you, Chair. Okay.
The next item is the Holton and MRWA Inter Authority Agreement. And Ian, you're going to take us through this.
I will do. Thank you, Chair. Members, in July 2007, Holton's executive agreed to delegate certain of their functions as a waste disposal authority to MWDA. The signing of the formal agreement was approved by NWDA in February 2008, and then services under the waste management and recycling contract with Veolia have been provided to Holton since 2009. The inter-authority agreement relating to that wasn't ultimately signed. A few years later, an inter-authority agreement was signed in relation to the procurement and operation of the RRC. Recently, Holton's executive have agreed to make certain changes to their services at their HWRCs, and these are services provided through MRWA's contract with Veolia. That is the subject of a separate and second report. And this decision has therefore placed renewed focus on the need for a formal inter-authority agreement relating to these services under the WMRC. A copy of the latest version of the draft inter-authority agreement, which remains under discussion between the two authorities, is provided in the report, and it outlines the key provisions in the agreement. I don't propose to go through those now unless members wish me to go through them separately. Members are therefore asked to approve the completion of an inter-authority agreement, to note the content of it, and to approve that the agreement be finalised by the Chief Executive in consultation with the Authority Chair.
Okay, thanks for that, Ian. Have members got any questions? It's basically just to formalise what already happens, isn't it?
Short and tall, that's exactly.
So if there's any issues, we've got an agreement that's in writing, and you can be fair to that.
Exactly.
Okay. Can we agree with your recommendation?
Is there any conditions in there that say if Holton do change the open hours and terms and payment schemes and all of that, and that impacts on the usage of the household recycling centres throughout the Merseyside Regional Authority? What more about them? Because,
well, I think that's covered in the next item, isn't it?
Shouldn't that be part of an agreement? If you're going to like agree to something, it should be like fairly formal, I wasn't thought.
That's right, so we're not like already signing off what then we're about to discuss in a minute.
Yeah.
That's
items
are in the wrong order.
Yes.
So some sort of prior notice arrangement.
Well, we have concerns about the next item, so we don't know if we're signing something off.
And then saying it's okay,
and then we
can do it later. Absolutely,
yeah.
It's not finalised, so I think Jeremy did beat that on board. We'll certainly discuss that at all.
So we haven't
those discussions can take place.
Yeah. So we haven't agreed.
It's not formal.
It's not officially been agreed by both.
We're noting that it's going on. Is that what you're saying?
Recommendation two, Chair, is that members delegate authority to me, in association with the Chair, to finalise it.
Mm. Okay.
Taking into concern our concerns.
Right.
In the next one.
Are we happy with that,
yeah?
Yes. Okay. Well, maybe we move on to the last item, which is the variation by Holton in relation to the contract. Ian, you're going to take us through this again?
I will do, thank you, Chair. As I've just mentioned, MRWA provides certain services to Holton under the WMRC with Veolia. Apologies for the acronym. Notably, the provision of two household waste recycling centres in Holton has done so since 2009. Halton's Executive Board has approved certain changes to be made to their service provision at those two housing centres. Excuse me. Namely, moving to standard year-round opening hours, introducing a Halton resident-only access policy, and the introduction of a charge for certain non-household items. Discussions around those changes and how they may be implemented through the WMRC have been undertaken between Halton, MRWA and Veolia, and are expected to be concluded shortly. MRWA will then need to undertake a formal contract variation process to implement the requested changes with Veolia through the terms of the contract. Whilst the proposed changes do present some risk to MRWA, they are considered by us to be relatively small, but will be closely monitored following implementation, and it's proposed to report back to members on the findings 12 months from implementation. Members are therefore asked to note the proposed changes Halton have agreed to make at their two HWRCs, and to approve that those changes be made to the WMRC by the Chief Executive in consultation with the Authority Chair.
Okay, thanks Ian. Obviously I'll bring members in, but first of all, can we just clarify, this does not affect the levy in any way whatsoever, does it?
No.
No, it doesn't. It doesn't, no. Yeah, but the data is on the risk, so
I disagree with that statement. I'm sorry, but if you make changes that increase tonnages in other areas, then that will be charged back to us, and it will affect it. Or is that or what I said there?
No, that's correct. That's correct. I think what Ian was saying was we have looked at the tonnages and what might come across to Merseyside sites, and the risk is considered marginal at best. In terms of overall tonnages, it's not. We're not talking significant. But of course, we don't know.
No, we don't.
And what we've proposed in the report is to monitor for the first 12 months and report back. Yeah. That might become an issue, point that Councillor Roscoe makes. May become an issue depending on the evidence from the evaluation.
But given what you just said, Carl, I mean, what other options are available? We're going to review it and see what the impacts are over the next 12 months. Are the other options that we could consider today to eliminate that risk?
There is a distinction, of course, and I'm sure it's not lost on members, sort of legally between Halton and the Merseyside authorities. Halton are perfectly at liberty to determine what their service needs are. They then ask us to provide services as they deem fit, and they pay for those services that we deliver on their behalf. They are not party to the statutory joint waste disposal authority arrangement that the Merseyside authorities are party to. So it wouldn't be the same arrangement for a Merseyside district would not be able to do something like this without the agreement of the Merseyside or the other Merseyside authorities, because we essentially operate shared assets. Halton is different. Halton's two sites are Halton sites. They're not Merseyside shared sites. Halton are delegating only part of their functions to us. They retain the right to make executive decisions about their services. The issue is, what services are we charging them for? What services do they need? And that's for them to determine. And therefore, what is the relevant charge for those services as Halton have defined? That is not the same position for other councils, Chair. So it's about the relationship. Halton are not part of the statutory joint waste disposal authority arrangement. They are simply asking us to provide the services they need and they define, and for which we charge. So does that make it any clearer, Chair?
Yeah.
I think it's clear. I just want to make sure it's clear. So can I just ask, this is a separate system that you run because they don't use fully, is this my understanding of it correct, fully Mersey Waste Authority, everything's not used there, it's only partly what you need. So you run half of whatever it is that you run, to pretend to understand what you run, but half of what you run, you run under your authority. To your concern, nothing to do with Mersey Waste, and then you have another part that you join into that you actually cost them for or
Halton have asked us essentially to provide certain services to them, but not others.
Yeah.
And we then charge them for those services.
So can I just ask, why is everybody else not allowed to, or are we allowed to do that?
Do we want to?
Do we want to do that?
would we be privy to, you know, these kinds of agreements?
A single district council could not unilaterally make the same decision in the Merseyside authorities. Yeah. That's the other five. Because you're part of the statutory joint waste disposal authority with a shared asset base, and the rules are different.
Okay.
That's a simple answer.
Yeah. I'll bring Laura and let's do that. Then so did you want
to? Doesn't mean it couldn't happen, but it would have to be agreed.
Yeah. Again, it was a different legal situation.
Yeah.
Obviously, you're showing us that legally people allowed to do that. I think it's still very disappointing, isn't it? Because a year or so ago, we fought quite a strong battle, we felt, from our side in terms of saying we didn't want to reduce any recycling facilities, that was a false economy. It was sending out the wrong message morally and politically, and it was kind of going the wrong way in terms of dumping stuff back onto councils in terms of clear and flighted and all the rest of it. So it was a false economy anyway. So we kind of made quite a strong stand that we wanted to protect all the recycling facilities that we had. Therefore disappointed, except you're not fully part of the Merseyside authorities, but this era of moving to a city region and so on that we should be moving to. It's supporting each other.
Okay. I'm going to bring Stephen in now.
Yes, thanks. Through our financial department, could we propose a separate financing charging policy for Hull, which would offset any future possibly operation to our levy? Is that feasible?
You want me to try and answer that, Chair? I will certainly take that idea back and talk to the Director of Finance, but as I understand it, there is an agreed methodology for calculating the charge to Holton for the services we provide. If at the end of the first 12 months the evidence shows that there is a lot of tonnage leaking across into other Merseyside sites, then we could take account of that tonnage within the charge to Holton as a kind of reconciliation arrangement. There is a big caveat with this, and I have to say this, there's a huge caveat with how do you know that it's displaced tonnage from Holton sites? You know, we've not got GPS tracking every vehicle. You know, we could maybe ask Fiola to look at surveying a sample of people who come through our sites as to which postcode they've come from, if you like. But that would only be a proxy measure. Now, that would be a discussion and a negotiation with Holton based on a sample or based on some evidence, because it's very difficult to know, unless you stop every car, to know where somebody's come from. Do you see what I mean?
Hang on, I'm going to bring Steph, who's going to maybe answer some of the questions that have been raised.
I fully appreciate what people are saying, but it's not something we've taken lightly. There's been site surveys, and there's a risk, not only if you come to Merseyside, but there's a real risk that it will go somewhere else, and not Merseyside, because there is closer local authorities. And what we do know by movement of traffic is that people are coming into Alton with massive amounts of waste, which Alton residents are paying for. And at the end of the day, we have to do something, because if you look at just the opening times, there is confusion about the opening times, even though it's on the site. I mean, I'm at Pickle Farm Road most mornings at 7 o'clock, and people are coming to put the waste in at 7 o'clock in the morning. They don't up till 8. So to have a standard time is, I think, a better way of doing things. And there is risk with things, but if we monitor them risk and mitigate that risk, for instance, there's no evidence of fly tipping when the site is closed. There's no evidence in all. So at the end of the day, we can only want the evidence we've gathered.
I was just going to say, on fly tipping, as of yet, we have no evidence. Is this up and running yet?
No, this is not. It's not till it's agreed.
Okay,
but
so
we have to deal with that. We'll deal with that.
And what everybody else will as well.
Yeah.
Hopefully some sites will be further away and might get it, but they might get a decision as well. And there's also the loss of jobs as well. That's a worry.
But that's why I have to protect what staff I've got. And my staff in Alton have got to be protected as well. And I've got to make sure that when reports go to the exec board, they fully understand that the risk to our staff, we don't make savings in our budget and don't deliver them, there's risk to our staff as well to be made, you know, at the end of the day. So there's a risk both ways, but we feel this is the best option for us. Same as you might feel there's a better option for what you do, at the end of the day, we will support that.
Okay, thank you, then.
I just wanted to make the point that I completely understand why we need to make savings. We've all been battered since 2010 and we're all having to make horrible choices, really horrible choices. I know you're doing your best to protect the vulnerable and the people who need an answer. This is why you've identified this, but I agree totally with that, Laura, in that affecting anything that, changing anything that affects recycling is really a false economy. I think that's where we're coming from. But also, the report does say that you're expecting to make savings not from decreased tonnages, but from a number of staff. So I think you think people are going to come within these reduced hours. So I think people are going to find it harder. I can say that it's a thin end of the wedge that we will all start to say, well, we'll have to do it now, we'll have to do it now. We'll all bring our hours down, we'll all have these payment schemes, and we'll all reduce services, and that's just going to. Yeah, it's going to mean recycling levels go down, it's going to lead to more fly tipping, and it's going to, and we've seen it in other areas. So that's really where the question comes from, and also that we are also getting battered, so, you know, by these cuts. So any changes that somebody makes that could potentially, because the levy has got to be monitored so closely, and there needs to be something in place there that says you'll get charged for it if there is an effect.
I share the concerns of others that it may have an impact elsewhere. As you know, Cronton, which is in Knowsley, is quite close to Widnes. So if somebody goes to a Widnes tipping station at 5 o'clock, it would be all right, they'll just nip up to Heighton there and drop it there, which, you know, there could be an effect there with an increase. In terms of changing the hours, what I do know is that when we change our hours from the summer tipping time to winter, and people forget we've had stuff locked against the gates and fly tipping outside our station. This could, you know, affect yourselves. Conversely, they could say, well, as we'll just nip down the road and leave it in the wilds of Cronton, which isn't far away.
That is always a danger. Stephanie?
There's always a danger at the end of the day, but I can only do the best for my residents. That's what I'm trying to do. Well, an example on me, but it goes off the thing at the end of the day. I'm trying to introduce food waste, and I'm finding that difficult at the moment because people don't want to use it. I'm offering people a weekly collection of food waste, which is the biggest problem we have, you know, in residual waste bins, is food waste. If you take that out, it makes things a lot easier and it saves you a lot of money. We can actually send it to Refoods to Widnes for a decent price. But at the end of the day, we're struggling to do that. And while the budgets are as they are now, I have to do the best for my residents, and you know, and I'm under pressure from the exec board to say you need to do something now, you need to make savings. You know, I'd like to be in things to say we're going to extend the opening hours, but we can't do that.
I mean, I understand that, because we've had this discussion. We all had this discussion many, many times. You know, and we always thought that was the worst sort of way to go, really. It gives out the wrong impression, And obviously, especially in the summer, I mean, if you're going to be closing at 5 o'clock and people are finishing work, I mean...
If I had the choice
between
social care and closing an old people's hall, or not letting somebody have the care that they need, as to opening the site and thinking, I know which choice I'm going to take.
We're all
under that pressure.
But there's a collectivism that we have commitment to it.
Okay. I look for better days.
You do,
Tony.
I mean, this comes back to my point with the finances, you know. We're calling a climate emergency here all over the UK. We're calling a climate emergency in Merseyside. We're going to have an extraordinary meeting in Wirral to call it a climate emergency. Recycling is the one thing that will prevent that, you know. So it's okay saying we're going to close this, we're going to reduce that, we're going to do the other. That's the last thing we should be doing in this present climate. And it does send the wrong message out, you know. We should be working 100% using the resources that we've got to up our recycling figures massively, you know. And this doesn't help. This doesn't help in one iota, you know. So, you know, what you said before is what you should be doing is increasing the hours in our recycling centres, finding the resources to do that. But, you know, we're getting battered, you know, by austerity, you know, right across the Merseyside area, you know, and that's very difficult. But I'm going to take the scenario regarding care and other council services that are being cut, you know. And in my
opinion, knows how to serve should be being cut, you know, but we're not in that perfect world. But I really am annoyed and disgusted, you know, that we are talking about reducing hours in recycling, you know, from a perspective of our waste authority.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I think we, the majority anyway, share your concerns, you know, we are disappointed that, you know,
to reassure people on recycling, we say to people, if you need one bin, we'll empty one bin. If you need 10 bins for recycling, we'll empty 10 bins. So on the recycling thing, we're a proactive council.
Yeah,
we're not saying to people, you know, don't recycle. We're saying to people, recycle, but recycle at home, because that's the best possible place to do it. Because you're cutting down the travelling. You've got the carbon thing to it, haven't you, at the end of the day?
Well, whatever's being said, whatever's being done, it's not working. Our recycling rates are going down, you know, not up. So it's okay saying we're doing this, we're doing that, you know, but we're not. Because the figures tell us that we're not doing it.
Yeah, okay.
I've just asked the amount of products though that we can actually put in those recycling bins is so small. The number of plastics is, again, we keep coming back to it, we need to find better ways to recycle more types of plastic. We can't just say it has to be a bottle and that's it. We've got to be able to recycle more things. And that's where we need to be facing now. Because they can't put, obviously, they're going to the tip, I call it. Because they can't put all of that stuff in the recycling bin. They absolutely would do, because they didn't want it in the house, do they? So we need to be finding better ways to do curbside recycling. We need to be moving forward.
It's not more bins, though, is it?
I
think it's a unanimous decision, because if you, all due respect, you're not a voted member on this. It's unanimous. And it's sending out the wrong message, isn't it? As Tony's saying, if we as local authorities or as a waste authority start reducing the ability and facilities and paid capacity for people to recycle, that has to be at this critical time, sending the wrong message. And we made a big stand about it a year or two ago, cross-party, cross-authority, that we didn't want to be seen to be doing that. It's sending the wrong political message.
I agree, yeah.
There needs to be a balance as well, because what we need to do is, I mean, I went to the supermarket this morning and picked up a bag of onions, and the label on said product of New Zealand. I thought, three onions in a bag, so all the way from New Zealand. You think the carbon, but it's only after, and but at the end of the day, the carbon footprint for that.
Absolutely correct.
We need to encourage people to recycle at all, and I fully agree with what you said about, but at the end of the day, we can't sort of collect recyclable stuff that's not recyclable, because they're just going to go somewhere else, aren't they?
As a consumer, you have a choice where you buy your onions from. When I go to the supermarket, my money talks and I can choose where I put my money. Yeah. But as a local authority resident, I don't have those choices.
Glad you know your onions.
I think it's the world we live in, isn't it?
Yeah.
We're living too fast and we're not thinking about the things we do, aren't we? You know, because recycling, it's simple. You know, it's so simple. The same on Merseyside, it's so simple, it's not difficult, is it? Not rocket science.
And yet we're still having trouble getting people to do it. So reducing any facility for them to do it is the problem.
We'd like to sort of stop producing any waste, wouldn't we?
Yes, we would.
Stop them producing it in the first place, and you wouldn't have to recycle it or reuse it.
That's the producer.
Yeah. Obviously, I mean, we can't stop halting. Do what they're going to do.
Telling them wholeheartedly.
We might express our disappointment, but also we're going to monitor, you know, the impact. But is there another option that we could, if we're concerned that we could have, you know, as a consequence of your actions, reducing the hours of the recycling centres and, you know, paying for mobile and non-household waste that we could impact on the rest of the districts, is there an option that we could introduce? I mean, I know that in Halton you're going to have a sticker. And you're not from, you know, sort of Halton, you won't be able to use the facility. Could we have a sticker so that you've got to be from Merseyside, and then maybe that could mitigate, you know, some of the problems that we could envisage?
If members want stickers, we can do stickers.
Right.
Would you like us to
recycle stickers?
Yeah.
Would you like us? Would you like us to produce a report or a briefing for you around some of the other options that you could adopt? And the price tag that might go with those options, yeah, because things cost.
As long as it doesn't impact negatively on the residents' ability to recycle and to access the centres, because we know these people having a laugh with the white bags and all this, but at the same time, residents should be able to access these services. That's what we want.
Yeah, and I think, Chair, that as we move forward and the emergency gets even stronger, collectively we've all got a responsibility to save this planet, because that's where we're headed, you know, none of us will be here, so put a cost on that, if you like, you know, so, you know, collectively we've all got to move together, and it's down to us as a waste authority, we're big players in all this, to send the right messages out, you know, and if we're going to be asking for behavioural change, we've got to be sending the right political messages out, because, you know, people on the ground, the lay people on the ground, how interested are they in recycling? The figures tell us not very interested. So we've got to get them to be interested, you know, encourage them to be interested. And to do that, you know, we've got to promote our facilities, our recycling facilities, and our strategy around recycling, you know. This is a top-down, bottom-up solution, you know. So, you know, we've got to be working at both levels to produce what we need to produce. But we've got to do that collectively, not just as Merseyside, but as a world.
So constituent authority is not just saying to Merseyside, you know, go and do a reply on behalf of us to government, because they're doing a consultation at the end of the day. We need to go back to the constituent authorities and tackle our own MPs, tackle our own chief executive, and say to them, lobby. Some of the stuff we're doing will give evidence to say, you know, we're cutting services to people that need them. You're on about recycling and waste and stuff, yet you're cutting the services, because we have to put money somewhere else that's more important. Yeah, so at the end of the day, that sort of puts everything together and we come forward as a region, if we can.
Yeah, absolutely. And one of the things, I mean, it's not about behavioural change, I think we're going to be seeing, after this meeting closes, there's going to be a video, isn't it? Are we still doing that?
Yeah.
Where we're trying to promote recycling, you know, and I think it's been on Merseyside TV, isn't it? So we'll watch that after the meeting's closed. Steve, did you want to...
Yeah, the suggestion Carl's just put forward. Am I right in saying Cheshire West did that?
Yes, the number of authorities have done that kind of trying to
see how successful it was or it wasn't for them.
It's an option. We can certainly look at it. There are a couple of other options based on things like automatic number plate recognition and reasonable use policies and things like that. So, you know, after if you six times in a week, it's okay, but 60 times in a week isn't.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? So we can help with a couple of options and report around where people are accessing sites from, not ours. Recognising the concern of members about restricting, but not coming from, you know.
Chair, what's the cost of all that? What's the cost of all that monitoring and everything? There must be a cost to that. You know, that's going to come out the levy.
Isn't that a lot already in place?
We're talking earlier about installing AMPR. It's not completely installed, but we've got a lot of sites already on AMPR. We're now getting all the data from those sites, analysing that data, which will inform our papers on what policy you might want to adopt based on some of the evidence from AMPR.
Yeah.
Okay.
So we want to tackle abuse, but we don't want to restrict household use in our centres. We want to encourage them.
Yeah.
So we'll have a report that will come back with some options in relation to what's being proposed.
What I might suggest, Chair, it might be an idea, rather than